Beacon Press Audio presents Until I Am Free, Fannie Lou Hamer's Enduring Message to America by Keisha N. Blain. This audiobook is narrated by Tyra Kennedy. Published by Beacon Press Audio, 2021. Introduction. A long fight ahead. We have a long fight, and this fight is not mine alone. But you are not free, whether you are white or black, until I am free. Because no man is an island to himself, and until I'm free in Mississippi, you are not free in Washington. You are not free in New York. Fannie Lou Hamer. I still remember the very first time I heard about Fannie Lou Hamer. It was in spring 2008, when I was a senior at Binghamton University, and I was taking a course on the American Civil Rights Movement. The professor had assigned readings on Hamer, including interviews and a speech Hamer delivered in the 1960s. I was blown away by what I read, and couldn't help wondering why it had taken me so long to encounter this fearless and extraordinary black woman. The more I learned about Hamer's life and her political vision, however, it became clear to me why she hadn't received the same level of attention and acclaim as so many others. She didn't reflect the public's memory of the civil rights movement. Mainstream historical narratives on black social movements, then and now, privilege the ideas and political activities of men. Most Americans connect the civil rights movement and black power era with black men such as Martin Luther King Jr., John Lewis, and Malcolm X, to mention a few. And when black women leaders enter the conversation, the focus tends to be on the same prominent figures, such as Rosa Parks, Coretta Scott King, and Angela Davis. Needless to say, these trailblazing leaders have all fundamentally shaped American society. Their work and lives should be deeply studied. However, the historical record is far richer and more interesting than many realize, including a diverse array of activists and leaders from different classes and all walks of life. Fannie Lou Hamer's story captures the contributions of a black woman sharecropper with limited formal education and limited material resources, but an all-consuming passion for social justice. Born in Mississippi on October 6, 1917, Hamer was the youngest of 20 children. The granddaughter of enslaved people, Hamer worked as a sharecropper for much of her life, a brutal practice closely mirroring the rhythms of slavery in the United States. From sun up to sundown, Hamer and her family cultivated cotton on a local plantation, expanding the fortunes of the white landowners as the Hamer family sank deeper and deeper into debt. At the tender age of 12, she concluded her studies at a local schoolhouse so she could help her family meet their growing financial pressures. Still, they remained trapped in poverty, the result of the exploitative nature of the sharecropping system and the violence used to maintain it. The difficulties of Hamer's childhood extended well into adulthood when she struggled to make ends meet. Despite her limited material resources and the various challenges she endured as a black woman living in poverty in Mississippi, Hamer committed herself to making a difference in the lives of others. Her life changed dramatically in 1962. At age 44, she attended a mass meeting at a local church in Sunflower County, Mississippi. organized by activists in the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC, an interracial civil rights organization. The meeting started her on the path to becoming a voting rights activist. Deeply moved by the words of the young SNCC activists that evening, Hamer learned of her constitutional rights as a citizen of the United States. She later said it was the first time she learned she had the right to vote. That year, Hamer became a field secretary for SNCC and worked to assist Black residents in Mississippi with voter registration. Activists in SNCC later praised Hamer for the role she played in amplifying their work and keeping them focused on accomplishing their goals. As for the SNCC part of her continuing movement life, she kept us on track, members of the SNCC Legacy Project noted. It was not difficult for a group of young people, like we were then, to sometimes stumble off course. She kept us focused on doing what was right. She commanded our respect as well as our love. When she joined the civil rights movement in 1962, Hamer decided to dedicate her time and talents to the betterment of Black people and other marginalized groups. In the years to follow, she launched a number of initiatives aimed at expanding voting rights, as well as addressing racism and inequality in her community and across the nation. Working alongside SNCC activists, Hamer spearheaded voter education workshops in the South, facilitated voter registration drives, and participated in marches and sit-ins throughout the region. Her efforts to expand voting rights for Black people in the South drew the ire of many, especially local white supremacists, who attempted to impede her political work at every turn. From the moment she joined the civil rights movement, Hamer became a target of violence, harassment, and intimidation. By extension, her loved ones also became the targets of local law enforcement. In one instance, Hamer's husband, Perry, Pap, was arrested and jailed. Local police also targeted one of Hamer's daughters, who was arrested in 1963. Hamer was also harassed for a water bill in the amount of $9,000, even though the Hamers had no running water at the time. And on one occasion, local police officers barged into her home all the way to her and Pap's bedroom in the wee hours of the morning, waving guns and flashlights with a litany of questions about her personal affairs. These incidents went beyond intimidation when Hamer endured a brutal beating in Winona, Mississippi in 1963. In June of that year, Hamer was traveling back home with fellow activists after attending a voters' workshop in South Carolina. They decided to stop in Winona to grab a bite to eat. What was supposed to be a quick rest stop became one of the most harrowing experiences of Hamer's life. The owners of the restaurant refused to serve Black patrons. Then, from the bus, Hamer noticed police officers shoving her friends into their patrol cars. Within minutes of exiting the bus, Hamer was grabbed by an officer who began violently kicking her. Later, at the police station, officers, aided by prisoners, unleashed a brutal beating on Hamer, which left her with permanent scars and physically disabled. Despite the painful and traumatic experiences, Hamer refused to be thrown off her mission. As activist Dorothy Height, president of the National Council of Negro Women, NCNW, once remarked, Hamer turned all of her own suffering into freedom and justice for her people. In the aftermath of the 1963 Winona beating, Hamer amplified her political work, determined to transform American society through an expansion of Black voting rights. Hamer not only helped to register voters, but also empowered others by entering the realm of electoral politics. In 1964, 1 year after she successfully registered to vote for the first time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.